these attributes. So this is the definition of the general definition of Tawheed, which is again, ikhwa, إفراد الله تعالى فيما هو حق له, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his rights. His rights include rububiyya, uluhiyya, asma'u sifat. While the specific type of tawheed is إفراد الله سبحانه وتعالى بالعبادة, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. And he said that, of course, the Shaykh here defined tawheed by which type of tawheed. He said إفراد الله بالعبادة, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. So which type of tawheed definition is this? The specific, right? The Shaykh, to define tawheed here, he used the specific type of tawheed, which is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. And this is mainly the type of tawheed is mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah. Because in many cases, the prophets and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and all the prophets, were sent to people who do not deny Allah's rububiyyah, that Allah is the creator. They affirmed that. But their main problem was in the issue of singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. They had a problem with that. They did not accept to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. They chose to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They chose to put mediators, intercessors, between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why the Shaykh was pinpointing the most important tawheed that people have gone astray in. Okay? So that's why he said, he stressed that the tawheed that we should be aware of, in which most messengers got into a quarrel with their people, got into opposition with their people, is the tawheed that calls people to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, the exalted he is. And of course, the word tawheed is used, we have proof for that. Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, one. Allah is one in his rububiyyah, one in his uluhiyyah, one in his names and attributes. When the hadith of Bukhari Muslim, when the Prophet sent Mu'adh to Yemen, and he said, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ, you shall come to people of book. فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدُعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ أَنْ يُوَحِّدُوا اللَّهِ. This is one narration in Muslim. أَنْ يُوَحِّدُوا اللَّهِ, to single out. Let it be the first thing you call them to is to call them to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. In different narration, أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ, or in أَنْ يَقُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So this all gives the meaning that worship. So even when it comes to defining لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, the word لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ deals with worship. So whomever says that there is no God or there is no creator but Allah, we say this is the wrong definition of La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. When someone says there is no provider but Allah, and he claims that this is the definition of La ilaha illallah, we say this is the wrong definition of La ilaha illallah. Yes, there is no creator but Allah, no provider but Allah, but this is not the definition of La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah deals with worship. That's why it says there is no deity worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, وَعَظَمُ مَا نَهَا عَنْهُ الشِّرْكِ, and the greatest of all which he has warned against is الشِّرْك. Again, الشِّرْك, like the Shaykh says, دَعْوَةُ غَيْرِهِ مَعَهُمْ, to subscribe others beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, the shirk has two definitions, general definition and specific definition, which is the shirk is the opposite of tawheed. So similarly, it has a general definition and a specific definition. The general definition is جعل شيء مما هو حق لله لغير الله, to make something which is the right of Allah
to Adam,
for other than Allah, which is the opposite of the tawheed, the general definition of tawheed. To make something which is the right of Allah for other than Allah. So people may do shirk in rububiyyah. People may do shirk in uluhiyyah. People may do shirk in asma wa sifat. We need to be aware of all that. The definition which is specific for shirk, which is to make the worship for other than Allah. Because the specific definition of tawheed deals with ibadah, right? Worship. So the opposite of it in the definition of shirk, which is the specific definition, to make the ibadah for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب and he said وهو دعوة غيره معهم. Of course he said دعوة. دعوة is دعاء. Okay. He did not say عبادة. Right. So maybe the one may claim that why did the Sheikh use دعوة or دعاء غيره معه and he did not say عبادة غيره معه. Why didn't he use the word دعوة which is دعاء? Again, the word دعاء may also mean عبادة. Like in the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir in Sunan, الدعاء هو العبادة. دعاء is the عبادة. So the Sheikh is using the دعاء, which is the most important type of عبادة, as an example or a synonym for the word عبادة worship. So again, and he used here in his definition, the Sheikh in this paragraph, he used a specific definition. Again, which is where people generally had gone astray. Many people had gone astray in the issue of worship, not in affirming Allah as a Rabb, creator, provider, and so on. Allah speaks in the Quran about the pagans of Mecca. He said that they, when they are asked, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَا يَقُولُنَ اللَّهُ وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَا يَقُولُنَ اللَّهُ. And when you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, the pagans of Mecca, they would say, Allah. And when you ask them, who created you? They would say, Allah. Meaning that even the pagans of Mecca and most of the people of the messengers before Muhammad did not deny that Allah is the creator. Their main issue with the Prophet sent to them was in the issue of worship and singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. So that's why he said to make dua to Allah. He chose in this definition of shirk, he chose the specific definition of shirk. And the proof for all that, he said, وَاعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. And worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not associate with him none whatsoever. So here we have a command and we have a negation. And ulama say, whenever there is a negation and the noun after it has no alat ta'rif, meaning the noun is used in a general form. When there is a negation before it, it means all type of that things should be avoided. All type of shirk should be avoided, whether it was major shirk or minor shirk. We'll come into talking about shirk in details, of course. The shirk is also divided into two types of shirk. We have major shirk and we have minor shirk. Okay? Both of them are evil. The major shirk, if somebody does, then he gets outside the boundary of Islam. He gets outside the boundaries of Islam. He is not a Muslim. Okay? He gets outside the boundary of Islam. Allah forbids him from entering paradise. Allah will make him dwell eternally in hellfire. Okay? And he loses the hidayah and security in this life and hereafter when he commits the major shirk. So major shirk is so evil. Whomever commits major shirk, merely worshipping others beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either by making dua, sacrificing for them, or doing any act of worship to other than Allah, this will make a person classified as a person who has committed major shirk. And we have minor shirk. Minor shirk is lesser than major shirk. Like doing some of the slight riya al-yaseer, slight show off, or swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or doing tabarruk in the walls of the Kaaba or the masajid, asking for barakah, blessing, such matters are classified as minor shirk. To have tatayur from bad omens from some of the animals, birds, and so on, this is classified as minor shirk. Okay, which we'll get into details in coming books, inshallah ta'ala. But minor shirk, whomever commits it, is still within the boundary of Islam. Okay. If he is punished for this shirk by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not dwell in hellfire eternally. He goes to hellfire until he is cleansed from this sin, and then he goes to paradise. Yet the ulama say minor shirk is so evil, and sometimes they classify it in a level higher than the major sin. So under all circumstances, a Muslim should free himself from any type of shirk, whether it was minor or major. Now let us quickly finish the remaining part here. He said, فَإِذَا قِيلَ لَكَ مَا الْأُصُولُ الثَّلَاثَةَ الَّتِي تَجِبُ أَوْ يَجِبُ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ مَعْرِفَتْهَا. And if it said to you, what are those three matters in which it is incumbent upon every Muslim to know? Of course, he said, then say, مَعْرِفَةُ الْعَبْدِ رَبَّهُ وَدِينَهُ وَنَبِيَّهُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. To know your Rabb, your Deen, and the Prophet. And those are the topic of the book. The three principles are the topic of the book. And these are taken from the hadith Al-Bara ibn Azib, Musnad Imam Ahmad, when the Prophet went to a janazah of an Ansari who passed away. And while they were preparing the janazah, he gave a short advice to the companions about when a person dies, how the angels of death come to him. If he is righteous, then the angels of Rahmah, mercy, will come to him with a coffin and come for Hanut for him to wrap him and take his soul, and will be taken to the heavens, and the angels of the heavens will praise him, and then he will be sent back to his grave, and then his grave will be asked by the angels of the grave, Man Rabbuk, Man Adinuk, Man Nabiyuk, those three questions. The believer will answer those questions easily. When he's asked, Man Rabbuk, he will say Allah. Man Adinuk al-Islam. Man Nabiyuk, he will say Muhammad. How did you know that? He said, قَرَأْتُ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ فَصَدَّقْتُهُ وَأَمَنْتُ بِهِ. I read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I believed it, and I accepted what was said in it. While al-munafir, or al-kafir, once he dies, the angel of wrath and punishment of adab will come to him. And his soul will come from his body like the cotton when it is separated from steel, how it is mixed with it, how much suffering he will be when he passes away. And they will take his soul up to the heavens, and he will be called by his most evil titles. And the angels would say, what is this bad smell? They would say, this is the bad and evil so-and-so person by his worst titles that he was called with in this life. And he will be turned back to his grave, and then he will be asked by the angel of al-qabr, the grave, Man Rabbuk, he would say, Ha ha la adri, I do not know, I do not know. Ma dinuk, Ha ha la adri, I do not know, I do not know. Man Nabiyuk, he would say, Ha ha la adri, la adri, I do not know. Meaning that, and then he will be punished after that in his grave. So that's why those are the three matters, principles, which are the subject of the book, in which the person will be asked in his grave, and the Sheikh will go into details talking about each one of them, what we have to know about each principle of those. Sheikh Al-Bas said, those three matters are the matters which combine the entire religion. Knowing Allah, knowing His Prophet, and knowing the Deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.